गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल. दिस इज अवर 10th लेक्चर सेशन ऑफ द कोर्स कंप्यूटेशनल फ्लूइड डायनेमिक्स. इन अवर प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी हैव सीन द कंडीशन ऑफ स्टेबिलिटी व्हेन वी वर हैविंग पैराबोलिक टाइम मार्चिंग स्कीम्स. आफ्टर दैट वी स्टार्टेड अवर डिस्कशन ऑन द अनस्टेडी कन्वेक्शन प्रॉब्लम्स. ओके, एंड देयर व्हाइल आई हैव इंट्रोड्यूस्ड यू टू द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ stability for the case of hyperbolic equations, we found that for hyperbolic equation we are having current number which is equal to c times delta t divided by delta x, and we found that for hyperbolic equations its value has to be less than equal to 1, and this particular stability condition is popularly known as CFL condition. Okay, after that I have started our discussion on the one dimensional wave equation, where we have considered del square u divided by del t square is equal to c square times del square u divided by del x square. Okay, and I told you that with the help of this 1D wave equation I will try to show you the physical understanding about this current number stability condition which is imposed over here. Okay, so what we will be doing now, this thing also I told you that we have written some characteristic matrix A, and then we have taken the determinant of characteristic matrix A equal to 0, and from there we have got that dx divided by dt is nothing but equal to plus minus c. So this is something which we have done yesterday. Now if I integrate this equation and avoid the constants, I will be finding x is equal to plus minus c times of t. So what I have done, I have integrated, and whatever the constant of integration have come, because this will be coming as intercept only, so I am actually not including it over here. Okay, so this is how we have seen that if I am having one dimensional wave equation, for this 1D wave equation I will be getting two different real characteristics of that equation. So one of the say if I write it separately, so it is x equal to ct and another is x equal to minus ct. So it means these two real characteristics nothing but represents the two straight characteristic lines, because we are getting this as equation identical to that of the equation of a straight line. So if we are considering it identical to equation of straight line, then obviously we are getting nothing but we are getting some equation, and one is having positive slope and another is having negative slope. Okay, now let me plot it on my xt coordinate system. So if I consider that I have x coordinate along abscissa and time coordinate along ordinate, let me consider some point I over here, and at a distance of delta x I have some point I minus 1, and at distance of delta x in the rightward direction, say I have some another point I plus 1. Now let me consider that the characteristic line, some characteristic line which is actually passing through this point I minus 1. So if I consider the characteristic line passing through this I minus 1, that will be something like this. Okay, so this will be my one line, and this line will be having equation as nothing but equal to, what is the equation of this line? Can you tell me? The equation of this line will be x is equal to c times of t. Similarly, I will be having one more line over here. I'll be having one more line which will be, say, passing through I plus 1. So what I am doing, I am saying that I have some point, say this is my some point over here, say this is my point P. So I have some point P over here, and I have considered that two characteristic lines are passing through point P. Now if my equation of these lines is plus CT and minus CT, in that case obviously when these two lines intersecting my this particular N time level, say this is my time level N, at that time these will be intercepting, same amount of distance delta x. And let us consider that same amount of distance delta x is nothing but our whatever the grid spacing between the grid points. Okay, till this point it is clear what I have told you. And let me also consider that this point I, whatever I am, this point P I am having, it is actually collinear in vertical direction with point I, grid point I. Okay, so now you can see this is delta x, and let me consider this as some delta t. Okay, so this time over here, because this is time level n, obviously if I have to calculate the value at point P, that will be some next time level n plus 1. So let us consider that the time difference between the level n and n plus 1 is nothing but delta t. Okay, so just we saw, or here also, from here also I can say that delta x divided by delta t is how much? If you see previously, our equation is dx by dt equal to plus minus c. So I can say delta x by delta t is nothing but c from here. Okay, so now if you see, this is our something which is coming from the characteristic line. So characteristic line, it means it is coming from the analytical understanding. So you can see that if I have to obtain the value at point P, if I have to obtain the value at point P, and if that value is obtained using point I minus 1 and I plus 1, that will be covering the entire domain of dependence in order to obtain value at point P. Okay. Now let us go into the definition of current number. So from here you can see, from the slope of this line, we are having delta x by delta t equal to c. So from this I can say that delta t will has to be nothing but equal to delta x divided by c. So that is something which we are getting from the slope of characteristic line. Okay, so this we are getting from the slope of characteristic line. Now let us try to see what CFL condition we are having. We are having CFL condition that current number, which is defined as c times of delta t divided by delta x, that has to be less than equal to 1. So let us first consider a limiting condition when our current number, which is equal to c delta t divided by delta x, is becoming equal to 1. So when my current number is 1, in that case what will be happening, I will be finding that delta t will become delta x divided by c. So if delta t is becoming delta x by c, so my point P will be once again located at same location. Okay, so which will be corresponding to next time level n plus 1. Okay, and for this point P, now I am obtaining the values by considering point I plus 1 and I minus 1 and I plus 1 numerical solution. So that's why I can say over here, the numerical domain of dependence is exactly coinciding with the analytical domain of dependence what we have considered. Okay, so this is one very, very important point. Is this point clear? What I am trying to say, physically what we mean by current number equal to 1. So first what we have done, by analytically finding the characteristics of the line and drawing these characteristics at some point P, which is at next time level n plus 1, we found that analytically if we draw these characteristics, the domain of dependence is coming below these two straight lines. Okay, and now what we did, we have considered our current number condition from the stability criteria, and from that current number condition, if we have subjected it to the limiting value of 1, we found that delta t is becoming nothing but equal to delta x by c. So if delta t is equal to delta x by c, in that case what will be happening, the jump, whatever this delta t step jump we have taken from time level n to time level n plus 1, that is becoming identical to the one which we are obtaining analytically. Okay, and also numerically also, we are considering node number I minus 1 and I plus 1 and I in order to find out the value at point P. So that's why all these points are nothing but exactly matching with the domain of dependence which is obtained using analytical formulation. Okay, so for this particular limiting condition, when current number is equal to 1, we can say that our analytical domain of dependence exactly coincides with the numerical domain of dependence and our solution will be stable. Is this point clear? Anyone is having any confusion over here? Please say yes or no. Can you all hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so if there is no question, then let me go to the next point. Now, next point, let us consider that we are having some situation where current number, which is equal to C times delta T by delta X, say it is less than 1. Okay, so what I am trying to say now, current number is less than 1. So if current number is less than 1, then what will be happening? My numerical time step delta T will be less than delta X divided by C. Is this point clear? What I have told? So if I consider current number as less than 1, in that case, my numerical time step will be less in comparison to delta X by C. So it means, while I am considering the analytical formulation, I was having this as my delta T, but now my numerical time step will be less. So say I will be ending up in some point P1 over here. So instead of point P, I will be ending up in reaching point P1, because now whatever delta T I am having, that is actually less than delta X by C. Okay. So now while I will be applying the numerical scheme, obviously once again to obtain the value at even point P1 also, I will be considering these points I plus 1 and I minus 1 only. Okay, so my numerical domain of dependence will be something which is I have shown by dashed lines. Is this point clear? So whatever the reason, now I have bounded by dashed lines, which is the reason in between P1 I plus 1. So P1 comma I plus 1 comma I minus 1. So whatever the reason I am getting in between these points, that is nothing but my numerical domain of dependence. Numerical domain of dependence for point P1. Now, can you tell me what will be analytical domain of dependence for this point? Can you tell me for point P1, what will be analytical domain of dependence? Any one of you? Are you all connected or not? You have just switched on to system? Okay. So can you tell me what will be now my analytical domain of dependence for point P1? Any one of you? Okay, so let me tell what will be happening. As I told, when I am considering current number less than 1, my delta T is less than delta X by C. So instead of reaching at point P, I will be ending up in reaching some time level which is less in comparison to point P. So say that I am calling as nothing but my point number P1. Now, when numerically I will be finding the solution, as for point P1 also, I will be considering I minus 1, I and I plus 1 only. So that's why my numerical domain of dependence is something which I have shown with the dashed lines. Okay. But if I have to find out the analytical domain of dependence for point P1, in that case, what will be happening? Because analytically for this equation, our slope of the line is fixed. Okay, so slope of the line is not changing. So the analytical characteristic lines through point P1 will be nothing but parallel to line which is passing through point P. So analytical domain of dependence will be something like this. So I will be having some line which is x equal to CP. It means this line is parallel to a line which is passing through point P. Similarly, over here I will be having some line which is x equal to minus CT, and this will be once again parallel to this another line which is passing through point P. So now let me consider that at time level n, this is obstructing this particular time level n at say points Q and R. Okay, so this is obstructing at points Q and R. So from here I can say that my P1QR over here is nothing but analytical domain of dependence. Is this point clear?
Yes, sir.
So P1QR is my analytical domain of dependence. Now you can see when I am considering current number less than 1, in that case what is happening? My analytical domain of dependence is completely bounded in between the numerical domain of dependence. So that's why analytically the domain which will be influencing the solution, numerically also we are actually bounding that one completely inside the numerical domain of dependence. So that's why our scheme will be stable. Okay, so this is one very, very important point, that as we are including our complete complete analytical domain of dependence into our numerical domain of dependence, inside our numerical domain of dependence. So that's why our scheme will be always stable. But whether our scheme will be accurate or not, that we cannot comment, because our scheme will be accurate when we are exactly considering our numerical domain of dependence equal to that of the computational analytical domain of dependence. Okay, if we are having difference between the two, obviously there will be some loss of accuracy, because as per analytical understanding, only this P1QR region should influence the solution at point P. But you are taking some region I minus 1 P1 and I plus 1, which is more in comparison to the analytical domain of dependence. So this particular region over here, an extra region which is now not, actually it is not affecting the value at point P1, but obviously in the numerical solution it is participating, so it may lead to some sort of inaccuracies. Okay, but irrespective of these inaccuracies, because it is completely bounding our analytical domain of dependence which is affecting the solution at point P1, so that's why scheme will be always stable. Okay, so from this particular example we can physically interpret what is the limiting condition CFL and how it actually affects our solution. So basically what CFL does, CFL always ensures that whatever our analytical domain of dependence is there, that is actually completely bounded in between our numerical domain of dependence, so that our solution should become stable. Okay, so it should not go into the unstability region. Now let me also consider one more situation, that what will happen if current number is greater than 1. Okay, so in that case what will happen? Let me once again draw this diagram and then let me show you. Can you tell me what will happen if our this current number is greater than 1?
Analytical domain of dependence go outside of the numerical one.
Yes. So that will make actually our scheme unstable. So let me consider some point P over here, and this point P is such that it is covering our analytical domain of dependence. Okay. So x equal to minus CT. Now if I consider, so this time step over here is delta T, which is equal to delta X by C. Now if I consider that my current number is greater than 1, if current number is greater than 1, C delta T by delta X will be greater than 1, and finally I will be finding that my delta T is becoming greater than delta X divided by C. So if delta T is greater than delta X divided by C, in that case what will be happening? In this situation, what will be happening, I'll be finding that my sum point P1, that will be actually outside the point P. So this will be my new delta T, which is greater than delta X by C as per the CFL condition. Okay. So now if you see, for the point P1, this, whatever the reason I am bounding in between the dashed lines, this is becoming my numerical domain of dependence. And if I have to find out analytical domain of dependence, I have to draw over here the characteristic lines through point P1, and characteristic lines has to be parallel to the lines which are passing through point P. So if I draw the parallel lines at point P to the characteristic lines, earlier drawn characteristic lines, then I will be finding that my, say this is my point Q, this is my point R. So now you can see my PQR is actually nothing but analytical domain of dependence, whereas I minus 1, P1 and I plus 1 is my numerical domain of dependence. So in this situation, what will be happening? Our numerical domain of dependence is not completely covering the entire analytical domain of dependence, which is affecting the solution at point P1. So if it is not covering the entire domain, in that case, obviously, what will be happening? We will be having some instabilities in our solution. Okay, and our entire solution will become unstable. Is this point clear? Okay, now let me go ahead with the next topic. So what I will do over here, I will try to give you some idea about instability, that what kind of features we will be getting in our solution when we are using some of the schemes which are actually which are not correct as per the requirement of the equation. Okay. So for this purpose, let me take one dimensional scalar transport equation. One dimensional scalar transport equation. And in this also, I will be only considering initially the convection diffusion term. Okay, which terms I will be considering? Convection diffusion terms. Can you tell me the equation? What will be the form of equation?
Steady state.
Yeah, it will be steady state, but mathematical form of this equation.
So u dt by dx is equal to k dt
del by let's of say rho u phi, that will be equal to mu times, here mu is viscosity, del square phi divided by del x square. Is this point clear?
Yes, sir.
So this is nothing but convection term. So this represents convection of some scalar quantity phi, and this side we are having diffusion term, which represents diffusion of some scalar quantity phi. Now phi can be anything, temperature, concentration, any parameter. Okay, so now as I have told you that this equation is one dimensional, so that's why what I can do, this del by del x I can replace with d by dx. So if I replace with d by dx, I will be finding d by dx of rho u phi, and that is equal to mu times d square phi divided by dx square. Now let me consider that I have some channel, and in this channel, say this is having length L, and here my x is fixed. Okay, so x is, this is x is equal to 0. So let us consider that at x equal to 0, now can you tell me, for solving this equation, what kind of boundary conditions we require, or how many boundary conditions we require? How many boundary conditions are required for this equation?
Two
boundary conditions. Any initial condition is required?
No, sir.
Okay, so for this we require two boundary conditions. So let me consider that at x equal to 0, my boundary is value is phi naught, and at x equal to L, my boundary value is say phi L. Okay. So now what will be happening over here? If I consider that during this entire domain, I have my density as constant. Okay. So what I am considering that over the entire domain, value of density is actually constant. Okay. And say my viscosity is also constant. What about u? So I am considering I have one dimensional situation. Let me now add one more parameter that I have fully developed situation. So if I have fully developed situation, then obviously value of u will be same at each and every point within the domain. And as situation is one dimensional, so that's why I can consider u also as some known parameter. And because of the fully developed situation, its value will be constant. Is this point clear? Whatever I have done over here. So what situation I have considered? I have considered that I have fully developed flow situation. So if I have fully developed flow situation, my u value will be becoming constant for the entire domain. And I am considering that constant value is actually already known to us. Okay. So if I take these assumptions, what will be my final form of equation? I can take rho times u outside the derivative. So inside I will be having d phi by dx. In the right hand side, I have mu times of d square phi divided by dx square. Okay. And that is now if I take this mu also on the other side, I'll be finding d square phi by dx square equal to rho u divided by mu times d phi by dx. Now this is nothing but one ordinary differential equation. Can you find out the analytical solution of this equation? Please say yes or no.
Yes, sir.
So the analytical solution of this equation is easy to find out. So I am not going into the details, but let me give over here the final analytical solution. So it will be phi of x equal to phi naught plus phi L minus phi naught times exponential of rho u divided by mu into x minus 1 divided by exponential of rho u mu into L minus 1. Okay. So if you solve this particular ordinary differential equation, analytically you will be finding the solution of this equation as something like this. Okay. So if I plot this solution on my axis, so say this is x and this side I have phi. So at x equal to 0, I was already knowing the value. Say this is my x equal to L and this is x equal to 0. Okay. So from here you can see when my this x equal to 0, at that time value was phi naught. So let us consider this as phi naught. And when x is equal to L, at that time value was phi L. So let us consider this over here as phi L. Okay. So now can you tell me what will be the nature of the curve which I will be drawing over here for solution of for variation of phi along x? So what I have to do, I have to substitute different values of x over here. So if you substitute different values of x over here, and if rho u by mu is positive, if rho u by mu is positive, in that case I will be finding the variation of phi as something like this. Okay. And when this rho mu by u is completely becoming equal to 0, in that case what will be happening? If this is 0, then my solution will be nothing but a constant straight line over here. Okay. And when this rho u by mu is negative, in that case my solution will be something like this. Is this point clear? Whatever I have done, nothing. I have substituted different values of x from 0 to L, and one time I have considered that rho u by mu is some positive number. Second time I have considered rho u by mu is some negative number, and third time I have considered it is equal to 0. So this line is when rho u by mu is positive. This particular line is applicable when rho u by mu is negative, and this is applicable when rho u by mu is equal to 0. Okay, so if you physically try to understand what is the physical meaning of this, let me explain in the next slide. So what is this rho u by mu, and if I include L also over here, length scale, what is this? Can you tell me in the numerator which force is this representing? Is it representing
convection?
Inertia.
It is representing inertia.
Yes, sir.
And this is representing
viscous force. Reynolds number.
Viscous diffusion. Okay. So apart from Reynolds number, one more number I can relate over here, because we are not exactly saying inertia force. Rather, we are talking about the convection term. Okay. So if I have to say the convection of by convection transport of any property divided by transport of the property because of diffusion, then we will be physically getting one non-dimensional number, which is referred to as Peclet number. Okay. So Peclet number will be, because why I am not saying over here inertia, because I am not only talking about the diffusion of velocity. Okay, I am talking in general sense. So there may be diffusion of temperature, there may be diffusion of concentration. So in general sense, I can say that Peclet number, which represents actually the relative comparison in between the transport of the property by convection and transport of property by diffusion. Okay, so that's why Peclet number definition I am considering as rho times u into L divided by mu. So now in my solution, which I have written earlier, phi of x, let me write phi naught plus phi L minus phi naught times, while I was having E rho u divided by mu, here let me multiply with L, and if I am multiplying, I have to divide also with L. Okay, so this minus 1 divided by, in the denominator I was only having rho u L by mu minus 1. So I can write this solution as phi naught plus phi L minus phi naught times of e power x by L into Peclet number minus 1 divided by e power Peclet number minus 1. Okay, so from here, now if I draw the solution on the x and phi plane, I can say that at this point it is phi naught, at this point it is phi L. So when my Peclet number is equal to 0, then my solution will be a straight line. When Peclet number is positive, when Peclet number is greater than 0, then this will be my solution, and when Peclet number is negative, then this will be my solution. So can you physically interpret it? What will be happening? So when our Peclet number is equal to 0, it means we are not having any velocity. So if velocity is 0, the transfer of property from left phase to right phase, or right phase to left phase, will be by which mode? Physically, it will be by which mode?
Diffusion.
It will be by diffusion. Okay. So because of this, we are getting one straight line. When we are having flow velocity positive, it means velocity is from left to right. What will be happening when velocity is from left to right? That diffusion try to propagate. So what diffusion does, for example, if I have some value at this center, diffusion try to propagate that value uniformly in the form of concentric circles. Okay, so uniformly in all the directions. But what convection will do? Convection will try to deform this circle towards the direction of the velocity. So whatever I am trying to say, are you able to get it?
Yes, sir.
So basically, when diffusion is there, diffusion will try to propagate the information uniformly in all directions. So rate of propagation will be same in all the directions. But when we are including the velocity, say there is some velocity from left to right. So you can consider a simple example. You are having some transparent pipe, and in that transparent pipe, first time, let us consider that you have filled the water. Okay. And that water is filled, but it is not flowing inside the pipe. What will be happening? Now, if at any location into that pipe, you inject some dye or you inject some ink, that ink will try to diffuse uniformly into the entire liquid. Okay. But if you now consider that flow is liquid is that water is flowing in that pipe. Now, if you add ink, what will be happening? That ink will be propagating in some certain direction. Okay. So that's why convection try to propagate the information in some unique direction. So that's why you can see over here, while our Peclet number is greater than zero, we are having more concentration of phi close to x equal to L, because initially it has not allowed the phi to stay in the left portion. Okay. It has transferred that phi immediately towards the right side boundary. And when Peclet number is less than zero, it means flow is happening from right to left. So when flow is happening from right to left, the more gradient of phi is actually existing at left side boundary. So physically, are you able to relate this point? Please say yes or no.
Yes.
Okay, so now let me go next to our main part, which is actually a numerical solution. Okay, so in terms of numerical solution, what will be happening if I consider rho u into d phi by dx, this is equal to mu times d square phi divided by dx square. Let me first apply central difference scheme. So if I apply central difference scheme, what will be happening? Rho u times phi at I plus 1 minus phi at I minus 1 divided by 2 times of delta x. This will be equal to mu times, what will be d square phi by dx square? Can you tell me?
Minus 2 phi I divided by delta x square.
Okay. So this is my equation. Now, this particular equation, can I apply to all my internal nodes? So numerically, what I will be doing, I'll be considering my domain something like this. This is x equal to 0. This is x equal to L. Over here, I have value phi naught. Over here, value as phi L. Now, let me consider over here number of intermediate nodes. 1, 2, 3, 4. So now, when I will be writing this particular formulation, I will be getting some system of equation, and that system of equations I can solve. Is this point clear? Can you solve this system of equations?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now let me go to the main point. While you will be applying the central difference scheme for both the convection as well as the diffusion term, how much deviation I will be having in my numerical solution and analytical solution, that let us try to see. So what will be the analytical solution for Peclet number greater than zero? This will be my analytical solution for Peclet number greater than zero. Okay. Now, if you use central difference scheme for your convection term also, that will actually create some oscillatory solution. Okay, so whatever the scheme I have told you, that will result in oscillatory solution. So whatever this line I have shown, that line is nothing but analytical solution. And whatever this line I have shown, these oscillations are actually numerical solution. And this numerical solution we are getting when we are considering our scheme as nothing but central difference scheme. Okay. Now I can also define Peclet number in terms of the mesh size delta x. Okay, so I can define Peclet number rho u delta x divided by mu. Okay, so now here what will be happening if I decrease the value of delta x? If I decrease the value of delta x and if I choose delta x such that my Peclet number is less than equal to 2, in that case, though I will be getting some oscillations in my solution, but the amplitude of these oscillations will be very, very small. Okay, so whatever this new line I am drawing with small, small oscillations, that line is corresponding to the situation when Peclet number is less than equal to 2, when the Peclet number is defined considering delta x over here as nothing but grid size. So over here you have to clearly distinguish in between the global Peclet number and the local Peclet number. Okay, so global Peclet number, when we are considering entire length scale as length parameter in defining the Peclet number, and when I am defining considering only small delta x as a parameter in defining the Peclet number, that Peclet number, if it is less than equal to 2, then my solution, though it will be oscillatory, but these magnitude of or amplitude of oscillations will be very, very small, such that the solution will be very close to the numerical solution. So is this point clear or any confusion? Now, can you tell me why this...
Sir, why the profile is same for Peclet number less than 2 and for greater than 0?
So, what I have not got your point.
Sir, the curve that is being followed by the solution is same.
Yeah, so curve being followed by the solution is same because Peclet number less than 2 we are saying, but we are not saying negative Peclet number, okay?
But it should not be like having coincident points on...
No. What I am trying to say over here, I am not changing any of the physical parameter in the domain. So every physical parameter is same, but the Peclet number, which is defined considering the grid size. Okay, so now I am not considering length, overall length of the domain in the definition of Peclet number, while I am saying this Peclet number. Okay. Now, can you physically tell me why upon limiting the value of Peclet number below 2, we are getting solution close to analytical solution with less oscillations? Can you physically tell me why this is happening? Can you give me some physical understanding behind this? Any one of you?
Domain of dependence is decreasing.
Yes, so let me consider if this is my I minus 1 and this is I. In first case, when delta x is large, and this is another situation where I minus 1 and I are very close to each other when delta x is small. Okay. So now if I have to calculate value at I, that will be obviously depending upon the value at I minus 1. So when I have large Peclet number, diffusion will try to propagate like this, but convection will try to propagate in this fashion. Okay, so if convection will try to create significant change, and if I consider small cells, so small cells, delta x is very small. In that case, what will be happening? Diffusion will be once again same, okay, and convection will be also same. So physically diffusion and convection are same, but in the first case you can see my I plus 1 point was very far away from point I. So when I was estimating the value at point I, because of the convection effect, the mainly effect was coming because of upstream node. Okay, so for this case, using central difference scheme is actually, for the convection term, is making our solution unstable. Whereas I am considering the small delta x, in that case, you can see the effect of convection, I am physically saying convection effect is same. So physically it should, it will be actually encapsulating the same amount of physical domain, but as my number of mesh elements are very, very small, so the node which is on right side of the I node, that is also actually encountered within the domain of convection. So that's why if we are including it, it as it is also participating in the solution, so that will not give us much error. So is this point clear, whatever what I have tried to convey? I don't know, today I'm not getting any response. Yeah, yes Abhishek. Sir,
please repeat it again.
Okay. So what I am saying, what I am saying that because of the convection, one thing is clear to us, when we are moving our flow from left to right, in place of having the concentric circles, convection will try to transport the information in some different manner. Okay. So this is say the transfer. So considering some information which is coming from point very close to I minus one, from that, that information say is convected something like this. So whatever this boundary I am showing, it is this information at point I minus one is affecting this much zone. Okay. When I am considering the second situation, then also because physically we are not changing anything. Okay. So our physical, whatever the density, viscosity, velocity we are having, that is remaining same. So physically, the domain of influence of this particular convection term will be same. But in first case, our delta x was very large. So that's why my I minus 1 and I part, only these were coming inside the convection domain. Okay. And I plus 1 was actually outside the convection. So it means this point I plus 1 is not contributing any value of phi for node I when I am considering relative to the convection point. Okay, convection effect. So that's why if I am using over here central difference scheme for obtaining value of convection term at point I, that will give me some errors because the node I plus 1 in physical sense, it is not contributing for the value of phi at point I. Okay, but if we are including it, so it will be giving some oscillatory solution. Whereas in second situation, if we are considering our delta x to be very, very small, so this I plus 1 is also now within the domain of convection. So that's why if I use this for obtaining the value at point I also, then though physically it should not be included considering the flow from left to right, but still at any given situation, whatever the convection domain of dependence we are having, it is becoming part of that domain. Okay, so that's why its inclusion will not result in significant error. Okay.
So sir, does changing the scheme won't help? Like we can use forward scheme.
Yes. Now I am going to that part only. Okay. So this point is clear. Shall I move further?
So sir, what is happening? Like for CDS, the magnitude of the error will decrease, but it will be in oscillatory nature.
Yes.
And in the case of forward, then the magnitude will be higher, but it won't be oscillatory.
In case of
forward scheme, the magnitude of order of the error should be higher than CDS.
Yes.
But
yes,
it won't be oscillatory.
Yeah. Let me explain that part. Okay. Now let me consider that I have this rho u d phi by dx that is equal to rho mu times d square phi by dx square. Now if I use the backward difference scheme for left part, so if I use backward difference scheme, then what will be happening? I'll be getting rho u into phi at point I minus phi at point I minus 1 divided by delta x. Is this point clear? that will be equal to mu times for d square 5i dx square. I'll be going with the central difference only because it propagates information uniformly in all directions. Okay. Okay, so now can you tell me what will be happening in the numerical solution? Say this is my analytical solution. What will be numerical solution? So whatever this dashed solution I have plotted, this will be my numerical solution. Okay, and in this numerical solution you can see we are having some significant difference in between these values, analytical solution and the numerical solution. So this difference will be decreasing when we are decreasing the value of our cell size. So when we are decreasing the value of our cell size, in that case what will be happening, I will be getting my solution very close to the analytical solution. Okay, so backward difference scheme, when we are using for the convection term, it does not give us any oscillation. Why it does not give us oscillation? Because whatever the value at point I am calculating because of the convection effect, that I am considering only because of the node which is on the left side of point I. So it says that whatever information will be propagating because of the convection, that will be only propagating from left to right side, which is physically also correct. Okay, so due to the physical exact nature of this one over here, we are actually getting no oscillations. Okay, but our solution is having significant difference from the analytical solution. So this thing is actually called as nothing but numerical diffusion. Okay, so this we call as numerical diffusion, and this numerical diffusion comes because if you see over here, if say this solution is at some Peclet number PE1, if I consider this dashed line as some analytical solution corresponding to some Peclet number PE2, what will be my Peclet number PE2? Will it be greater than PE1 or less than PE1?
Greater.
Less. Can you tell me why it will be less, Abhishek?
Delta x, I think delta x shouldn't be.
No, I'm not talking about delta x. Now I'm saying in the physical parameter sense. So okay. You can see the solution at the center is corresponding to Peclet number equal to 0. Okay. So when we are increasing the Peclet number, when we are increasing
velocity is decreasing.
Yes, either we are decreasing the velocity or we are increasing the this one viscous term, mu term. Okay, so over here basically our Peclet number definition is rho u divided by mu times L. So what I am trying to say over here, that numerical diffusion will increase. So solution will try to go towards the lesser Peclet number as per the analytical formulation. Okay, so that's why we will be having occurrence of some apparent viscosity in our numerical solution, and this apparent viscosity will be more in comparison to the actual physical viscosity. Okay, so what will be happening basically, while we will be considering the numerical solution, the effect of this numerical diffusion can be decreased by either considering lower value of delta x or by considering the higher order upwind difference schemes. Okay, so now what I will do, obviously over here I have just introduced you this concept. We will further study this concept in more details while we will be studying the discretization of convection diffusion equation using finite volume approach. Okay, so what I today, whatever I have discussed, with this I will be now closing our discussion on the finite difference methods, and based on this I will give you one assignment, one coding assignment, which you have to do in a period of say 1 week or 10 days. Today itself I will try to upload this assignment, and From our next lecture onwards, now we will start our discussion on the finite volume method based discretization. Okay. So now if you are having any questions that you can